This is one of the panels that I was most excited for of all of MINECON, because this person right next to me is one of the most, if not the most talented person that I have the pleasure of knowing, Mr. Greg Aronowitz. He can basically, I don't know, craft, like, give him this water bottle and a little glue and you'll have a masterpiece. Wait, actually? Okay, funny story. No, funny story, in California, they did a beach cleanup and Greg made a huge whale out of all the trash on the beach, and that's in Long Beach Aquarium. So he has actually made art from water bottles. Greg is as talented as they come in every possible way, vision and ideas and then actual execution. I couldn't get my family out of the barnyard when I took them in the other night. I was like, let's make a quick run through. I have a lot of work, but they're like jumping on the horses and like trying to steal cats. And I was like, guys, we have to go. But without Greg, MINECON would not be anywhere near as wonderful as it is. And I would venture to say it would be much, much, much less exciting. He makes dreams come true of being able to walk into something and feel like you're in his game, in the middle of the game. And if you haven't visited the Minecraft experience in the hall, who's been there? Okay. We have the super fans in here. It is one of the coolest things that I have ever seen, like the dioramas and the barnyard. So I could literally talk the 40 minutes, but I figure you might want to hear Greg. You've heard me enough. But Greg Aronowitz, please put your hands together.
Wow. Is this one on? Yeah. I wasn't nervous about doing the panel, except now how am I supposed to live up to that? Like, now I feel like... Well, how is everybody doing?
Good.
Yeah? Everybody having a good MINECON?
Yeah.
Yeah? Excellent. Well, Lydia has been a friend of mine for many years, and Voo, do you guys all know Voo? Voo Booey, running around. Is he still segueing everywhere? And they came up with the idea for MINECON a couple years ago, and we're planning events and just all the things that would be at a convention, but I ran into them at BlizzCon. Is anyone here going to BlizzCon? Wow, so we have, this is like hardcore Minecraft all the way. That's awesome. That's awesome. Well, BlizzCon, if you don't know, is Blizzard's convention celebrating World of Warcraft and StarCraft, and it kind of has the same idea, but they do, it's about like competitive gaming and stuff, but they have all these big statues there of characters from the game, and Vu and Lydia were looking at them and saying, you know, we kind of need something like this, but for MINECON, because we're going to do this little event in Vegas called MINECON. And they said, would you be interested in making some stuff? And I said, of course, that would be great. And when is it? And they're like, oh, I think it's in like 3 weeks or something like that. I was like, oh, okay. That's how it all started. That first year, you know, we ended up spending about 12 days in the end to create stuff, and we made some animals and a little photo opportunity, and then this like 20-foot tall creeper in the middle, and we thought that was like epic, and it just grew from there. All of you guys responded really positively, and we wanted to make it bigger and better. So this year, I feel like it's the biggest and the best so far, but it's gonna get bigger and better. So you know, just make sure, keep telling everybody that you want to see more, and we'll just keep doing more. But I wanted to kind of talk to you guys about what it took to make all of the stuff, and then like kind of see from, like, I talk to people all day on the floor, but I want to know directly from you, like, what you liked the most and what you want to see more of, and then I also want to, are there any artists in here? There's some. No, there's like no one raises their hand over there. So this here is the Barnyard Effects team, if you guys want to stand up. So I get to be up here, you know, doing the panel, mostly because everyone else is like, I don't want to have to talk to anybody. but they make it all happen. And, you know, every project, everybody that deals with stuff, they're like, you know, we and put all these hours in and we worked really hard. But, I mean, I honestly have to say, like, legitimately, like, we do all the hours. Like, these guys for the past 6 weeks have been doing 18 to 20-hour days. And then in the past week have been doing, I guess, like 22 to 24-hour days. 85 hours just in Florida. Yeah, and we haven't even been here a week. So if that puts, so this actually is the first MINECON, though, that we participated in. Like, I'm thankful to even have a panel. The first one I slept through because I'd been up for 3 days straight. And then, last year we didn't even know which side was up. So it's really exciting to be here. But definitely, if you see them walking around, like, you know, get their autographs and get, because all the things you see and love, like, they make it happen. But I want to show you first, just so if you're wondering, like, why am I here talking? Who am I? I'll give you a quick little background. I do this for fun, but what I do ordinarily is film, television, movie props, stuff like that. I know at the opening ceremony I talked about it a little bit. Like, I wrote and directed Power Rangers. Any Power Ranger SPD fans here? One, yeah, ooh, a couple. And I made models for Spielberg for 11 years and worked with Jim Henson and I don't know. I'll show you and then you can see. And then don't make fun of my hair. It happened. It was the 80s, right? So let's see. Mm-hmm. I selected it. But, so tiny. I don't know. I'm not an AV person. Is it? I don't understand what's going on. Oh, why is that one playing? The icon is playing? I've never seen that before.
He's artistic.
Yeah, it's... It is true, though. I have one skill set. Real life, I can't do it at all. Let's see. There we go.
Maybe. Do we have music?
No, we have no sound.
Nice detail work on this.
So it's not just me.
It's great. Yep. Guys and gals, Greg is great. Right over here. Really good, Greg.
Over this. So what you're seeing here is just sets, models, props, all things I made for film. Like, I helped design all of the sets for Saving Private Ryan. All of the stuff in Normandy and everything was built from the ground up, and we had to make it look like it was bombed out. I built Jodie Foster's spacesuit in the interior of that pod for Contact. Anybody here seen Contact? Yeah. How about this? Are you guys familiar with Felicia Day and the guild? I designed the guild and make all the props and everything for, interestingly enough, this clip has no props in it, which is really weird. It does look like me. Will Wheaton's personal fantasy. I made that for Machinima. Any Machinima fans in here? Yeah, they had a live stream broadcast for Saints Row, and we made this. They gave it away. This is about a game station, and you guys go on game station. Super Bowl commercial. We made all the stuff for this. I haven't actually watched this yet. How many people actually like this Batman? Marisa, thank you. At the time, we thought it was cool. Pretty much in this movie, or these two movies, anything anyone picks up, I made. I do a lot of makeup effects and body casting and stuff, and there's a lot of celebrities that I'm the only person that'll let me actually do their body cast. Arnold's one of them. He calls me Little Man. He's like, no one touches me but the Little Man. This is a miniature plane. I don't know if anyone saw this movie with Mel Gibson. Story went crazy. But sometimes you have to do these things, like, you know, here we're hoping all the stuff we made from MINECON will, like, stay intact, but sometimes you spend weeks and weeks and months building these things, and then they just drop them off a crane and destroy them. X-Files, any X-Files fans? And did Jillian's makeup here? Okay. Babylon 5, yeah. So I did all the original makeup designs for Babylon 5. If you remember in the pilot, there were a bunch of puppets. I made all the puppets because they wanted it to not be Star Trek, where at the time Star Trek was all just about like a nose appliance or a forehead appliance. They were like, we want these really weird aliens. So we made all this stuff. And then they were like, okay, this is too weird. So when it went to the series, they just dropped all of that. Stuff. This is actually the first movie I ever worked on here. It was called Space Invaders, and I was hired as an assistant, just like a production assistant, and they let me draw some stuff. I ended up designing the costumes, and then the director, it was a very low-budget movie, he kept coming into the production office going like, you know, I need someone to make this like alien, or I need someone to do this matte painting. Can anybody here figure it out? And I was like, I'll give it a shot. And I did all this stuff. I ended up doing all these things on the movie. And then Spielberg saw the movie and he kept saying like, oh, I really like that costume, or I really like that matte painting. Who did it? And they're like, oh, this kid Greg. And by the end of the movie, when all the things he picked out he liked were done by me, he's like, well, we should probably get that kid in here. That hair, what was I thinking? As you can see, there's like, you know, robots and puppets and costumes and... There we go.
People from the movies making zombies and monsters and stuff.
At the end, that was from the first movie I worked on. I made both their costumes, and that's Ariana Richards. She went on to be, she's the little girl in Jurassic Park and stuff like that. That was her first movie, too. But in that clip, she says, talking about her uncle, and she says, he makes zombies and monsters for the movies and stuff. So I don't know, I always put that in there. So it was great to work on her with that, and then years later be on the set of Jurassic Park and see her, and, you know. But, so... for me, when I was a kid, I saw Star Wars. And the thing I always say about it is after the movie, when all my friends were running around saying, like, I want to be Han Solo or I want to be Luke Skywalker, I was like, I want to be George Lucas. Like, I want to make all that stuff, you know? That was, like, the first movie, I think. Even I was a fan of, like, Wizard of Oz and other fantasy movies, but Star Wars was the first one where my mind was able to put together the fact that somebody had to create all those things to be in the movie. Like, not only the story, but, like, you know, and that's a great example, because a lot of other sci-fi movies, like, they'll still find existing things to put in the background, but Star Wars, every single thing that they use was somehow created. Even if they took a bunch of existing things, they put them together in a way that you never saw. Like, a lightsaber is made out of an old flash bulb holder of, like, a antique camera, but that's not what you think it is when you look at it, you know? And so I really kind of chose at the age 7 to just, like, set this path to be able to be, like, someone who makes stuff. And watching all the behind the scenes of Star Wars, because that was one of the first movies where they actually really showed you how things were made, I thought that, like, it was just a small group of people, i.e. Barnyard Effects, that did everything. And it wasn't until I got to Hollywood that I realized that it's all kind of segregated, and, like, the costume people make the costumes and the prop people make the props. But I had kind of tried to work up this skill set my whole life to be able to do everything. And when I found out that it wasn't how it was done, I was like, well, you know what? I don't really care how people do it. I'm still going to try and do everything. So in all these movies and all the different things that I work on, I try and do as many different aspects as possible. And it just ends up being super fulfilling. And also, we stay very busy, because if you do a specific thing, if you are a model maker, or if you are a matte painter, or even, like, for CG, if you're, like, just a, like, if you just do creatures, when there's, like, a lull in that, in the demand for that, you end up finding some space. But because we're all over the place, like, one week we'll be doing makeup effects for a Fox TV show, and then the next week we'll be doing, you know, models for the new Michael Bay movie, or sets for a popular YouTube show, and it keeps us really, really active. But MINECON is, like, the one time a year where we try and stop everything else and focus just on that show, but still using all those different tools, like, all of the amounts of, you know, working with the fur, and then this year with the miniatures, and then building all the sets, and then, you know, the welding and the engineering for the giant statue. So it all comes in handy. And I'm going to show you, unless I totally mess this up again. And now, is Lydia gone? She can't help me. Let me see. Double. Thank you. There's Red 5, the resident computer tech. Okay, double click this. I'm learning. Thank you. Yeah, I've been so busy getting everything ready. That's actually the first time I've seen that video. So it's, but watching it, what I notice is that you can see like every one of those guys, you know, like while we're all working on it, just like, you know, the love and care and like the attention, it's like nothing's just like slapped together. Like everything was planned out. Every pixel, we matched every skin from the game to make sure we got the textures right on the animals and all the fur when we couldn't find, you know, Red 5 would spend hours online trying to find like all the different types of fur for the animals, and if we couldn't find a specific color, then we like dyed it ourselves, and some of the synthetic furs can't be dyed, so then we had to like create ways that we can like color it and find it. It was this huge process, but it was all done to try and make it like the best experience for you, and you know, I don't know, was it worth it? Yeah. Awesome. Well, that's good to hear, because, you know, I guess mostly what I want to talk to you guys about, like, as you know, as an artist and the other artists that are here and just anyone that has any kind of dream. Yeah, I grew up in Jersey, and there's like one person, like, yeah. But, you know, the whole concept of the, you know, my love for Star Wars and all the fantasy stuff and the fact that I wanted to, like, draw and paint and build stuff all the time was just something that was not... particularly at that time, like super socially acceptable. And, you know, people would be like, that's cool, you're having fun. Like even my parents would be like, you know, whatever, have fun, but grow up and like really figure out what you're going to do with your life. And I was like, no, this is it. This is what I'm going to do. And their basic concept was like, that will never amount to anything. Like you'll never be able to make anything of yourself or for yourself. And the truth is that is not true. You know, if you love something, if you're passionate about it, if it makes you happy, follow through and your life will be amazing. You know, and that's for, I just need to say that to everybody here, everything you dream. And Minecraft to me is what I feel like it is to you guys what Star Wars was for me. And when I see kids playing this game and building like entire like countries in there and like the detail, what I'm always blown away by is the fact that like the aesthetics, you know, like they're not just building blocks. Like even me as a kid, like building blocks, I'm like, oh, it's a generic house, but it's like they'll build like everything that you guys build. It's like you'll follow through with all these rules of architecture that's like region specific and you know, period specific. And you may not even be aware of the amount, like people go to school for years to learn like what Japanese architecture is or what, you know, different, you know, cultural influences are on like the building of structures. But I look at these things, I'm like, these guys are nailing it. So like, I feel like any one of you can probably just instantly like pass the, you know, architecture test or whatever that would be, you know, it's like, because it's so much more than just a game and stacking things up. I know the physics is weird, you know, which is something we fight with all the time and trying to bring it to life. But it's just like that, inert understanding of what the real world is and bringing into that game. And I just want to encourage all of you to take all that creativity that you utilize in the game and pull it back into the real world and just like make stuff, you know, because I want to come to some show where you guys make all the stuff and I get to walk around and check it out. That's, you know, because I think it would be amazing. It's like I want to go into all your worlds and all your minds and see all that. So does anybody have any questions about any of this stuff? I see you were first right there.
Back to your movies, did you do any work on the Labyrinth? What's kind of like the same
kind of thing? No, I did not. I was really young when that... Okay. I was really young when that came out. I actually vaguely remember going with some friends and their parents, and they all walked out going like, what was that? That was terrible. And I was like... that was the greatest thing I've ever seen. And, you know, I got to work with Jim Henson for a couple years. And my goal right now, what I'm working on, is a movie, my own movie, that's a Christmas movie done in the style of, like, Dark Crystal, Labyrinth, and Neverending Story. So thank you for bringing it up. It's a very underappreciated thing. That was pure genius on Jim's part, and people didn't get it.
So looking... I think we kind of grew up in the same era, the Star Wars, and Dark Crystal was a huge movie for me. But you know, things have changed so much with the way movies are made, and mm-hmm. I imagine that your job, so to speak, is changing with the advent of CG. And even when Lucas made Star Wars back in the day in your Michael Bolton era. Sorry, come on.
I mean, prefer to think of it as my Farrah Fawcett era.
That's good. I mean, the way that Lucas made those movies compared to when he remade, and I'll say Jar Jar Binks, so everybody. So that, I mean, it was so different the way you make movies. Is that affecting your career and the outlook of your job?
It does, not necessarily in a negative aspect. I'll tell you what, when we were working on Jurassic Park and those first CG dinosaurs came in, like, people put down their coffee mugs and said, okay, we're done. Like, it's, you know, the computers are taking over and we'll never work again. And that's not true. Even the full, like, CG, like, Pixar movies and stuff, they still need the designers, they need the sculptors, the model makers. Ooh, I almost slipped up. I was going to say, a very prominent director just called me to ask about doing models for his new huge CG movie. That's all I can say. But it's like, so they still want the physical to figure out the computer stuff. So it has changed in that my product may not always end up on the screen, but we're still like in there making, there's still that human factor where people need to be able to touch it and hold it and walk around and look at it to, you know, really appreciate it and then finalize it in CG. CG, just like anything else, is like a great tool. I find that the best movies are the ones that use it as an additional tool or color in the palette and not where they just rely on it completely.
How young were you when you first started using power tools, and did you have any misadventures as a child experimenting and learning process?
I say most of my misadventures for now, really. But I started very young, probably 6 or 7. I think, you know, my grandfather had some stuff in the basement, and I probably did it all wrong, you know, using jigsaws to cut, like, try and make giant straight cuts. And then, you know, just access to materials was so limited. What I found most interesting about it was, because I didn't have access to the proper materials, even though now I have access to anything, I created all these techniques that I would use as a kid that I still use now. Like, the crew will tell you, like, my number one thing is Bondo. Does anyone know what Bondo is? If you get a dent in your car, you put it on there. And when I was a kid, I wanted to make a mask, like, a, you know, some alien. And I went to the store, and they were just like, I think I was looking for latex, and they're like, well, we don't have that, but use Bondo, it's the same thing. And I was like, it is so not the same thing. But but because it was like, you know, I was forced to try to make it work, I developed all these techniques, and to this day, it is like my number one go-to material.
Awesome. I'm going to take some over here, then I'll walk over there. Don't worry. Okay. Here we go.
Looking at all that you've done, and it is very extensive, what would you say is your most memorable or most complex project?
Wow. First, I want to say you should have your own talk show. You have an amazing voice. let's see. That is such a hard question. The ones I'm most proud of, I would say, are Saving Private Ryan, Contact, and you know, like the Jurassic Park Lost World sets, because I got to design that whole set for the end of the movie, you know, which was super cool. AI was probably my most memorable experience, because I got a call. I was working on Minority Report, and I got a call. Steven wants to see you, which is always like, you know. I went in there, and he was like, listen, I'm not going to do Minority Report. I was like, what? Does that mean I'm fired? What does that mean? He's like, no. I am going to do, you know, Kubrick had just passed away, and they were trying to do AI together, and Warner Brothers didn't want that to happen because they're two super huge directors, and they're like, this will never. So Kubrick basically, like, willed AI. Does anyone know AI? The movie AI? to Stephen, and so Stephen had all of Stanley's notes and drawings and everything. Stanley worked on that movie for 20 years. It was his passion project, but he never felt that he was quite in the right mindset to direct it. He wanted Spielberg to be involved because he wanted that youthful, outlook. And Stephen said, Sony's going to kill me because I owe them Memoirs of a Geisha, and because he decided not to do that to do Minority Report. And he said, Fox is going to kill me because we're starting Minority Report, but I don't want to do it. I want to do AI. He's like, you and three other people will be the only people in the world that know this is happening. And we got like secret code badges and all this stuff. And for months, I got to go and just look at all these notes from both Steven and from Stanley, who are two of the greatest directors in all time, and just kind of like have the inside look of what was happening and help guide the path of that movie. And he wanted to keep it so secret that he let me work at home, and we started designing these huge models of like all the cities and stuff. And so for about a year, the world of AI was in my living room, and no one else got to see it. So it was pretty cool.
Awesome. And okay, one more question over here, then over that way.
Okay. Hi, Greg.
Hey.
First, I just want to thank you. Mojang would probably agree that you're the most important person here. Without you, we would be visiting an empty airplane hangar. So, thank you.
Well, thank you. That's a huge compliment.
I wanted to ask, you seem very much a geek, and you probably geek out like most of us on a lot of things. Is there a specific movie or IP that you would want to get your hands on?
Oh, there's so many. I mean, I am a geek. I almost had a heart attack today. I got to meet Mark Ruffalo. That was like amazing. And there is. I guess I trust you guys. I can tell you and you won't steal it from me. There's a series of books that I absolutely love by an author called Garth Nix. And they are the Abhorsen series. Has anybody read these? It's interesting because it's kind of like, I think they're like the greatest books ever written, and they're not super well known, but of course, he's an Australian author. It's basically like if you took Star Wars and Harry Potter and like stuck them together, you would have these books. They're amazing, and I see the whole world in my head, and they're not unknown, they're just not super well known, but of course, some studio came in and was like, oh, we'll make these. And they bought the rights, and they'll probably never, ever make it. But I it's kind of my mission to one day be able to pull those out and make them as big as a Harry Potter type thing. And you should read them. I definitely check them out. It's called the Abhorsen series by Garth Nix. It's all like magic and all kinds of stuff.
Hey, how you doing, Greg?
Good.
John from Cherry Hill, New Jersey.
Nice.
Thanks. I saw Lydia at the Dr. Seuss train ride there. So I said hello the same way. But question: how much failure goes into like making your props and your set designs? I mean, you're off by a couple inches here, this and that, and like you have to restart.
Depends how late it is.
Yeah.
So.
Okay.
There is no failure in art, right? So it's all interpretation. I mean. We run into all kinds of problems. I mean, I could probably sit here for days and tell you stories about, bringing sets to a location and having them not fit through the door. The question earlier about like learning things when I was earlier, it's like that would probably have been. I did when I was like 14 years old. I used to do commercial art for this firm. They thought that I was like 21. They had never met me. They just looked at the art. So they used to hire me, and they actually ended up being like this whole scandal because it was like underage labor. But I did this, billboard for McDonald's when I was like 14, and I did it in my room. I built the frame and stretched the canvas, and then I was all done, and I couldn't get it out of the room. And so we had to cut it in half, and then, like, yeah, it was just... So I learned early on that you have to, like, try to be thinking ahead as much as possible, but at the same time, it doesn't matter how much you plan. If it can go wrong, it will go wrong. And it's just all about, going with the flow and trying to figure it out and not panicking and making it work. And I think it's even Lydia says to me, because I'm always like, you know, this was supposed to happen and it doesn't look good. And she's like, but you're the only one who knows that, you know.
I get that from my mom, actually. She's the one that says that. But.
There's little things all through the experience that I'm still not happy with, that, you know, stuff that was supposed to be in there that didn't get in there. But, you know, I'm the only one who knows. So as long as you guys are happy, I'm happy.
I think you could explain all of MINECON 2012 as the if everything went wrong, it would go wrong.
Well, that
was last year.
I
so
never
we tried
to be
make
in the hospital.
We tried to make this year easier MINECON wise. Here you go.
Do you play Minecraft?
Oh, the question, the loaded question. No, here's the thing. You know? I was given, you know, my own code and stuff. I went in there for like 10 minutes and I was like, oh my God, I may never leave this chair. So, you know, I try to learn as much about it. And, you know, my whole crew are experts and they all go in there and play it. I guess I have a bit of an addictive personality. I'm pretty much addicted to my career and to building things. And, you know, people say, like, well, you don't take vacation. And I'm like, well, if I had time off, I would just make something else that it just wouldn't have a deadline, you know? Because I have all these things that I want to do. You know, the game is just such an amazing resource to be able to go in. And so it's fun to go see things, especially, you know, when there's new stuff in there. I want to go check it out. But, yeah, I would basically say, like, if you guys were like, Greg, you have to play or we won't like you anymore, then chances are next year there would be, like, half the stuff of MINECON because I would just be playing all the time, you know? So, but I have, like, I think I have, like, you know, the greatest mod available because, you know, I get to make it physically and then bring it here. So that's my version of Minecraft.
I have a daughter that wants to, she's chosen special effects, makeup, and prosthetics as what she wants to do for her career.
Mm-hmm.
I'm sure there's a lot more options insofar as school and training programs now than there were available for you, but it's still a pretty unconventional career to choose without a career path, clear path for education. I was wondering what you would suggest.
I don't know, what, we'll get a survey from the, do I give the honest answer or the... This is the thing, and, you know, I feel like this is like, you know, I wouldn't say American society, it seems like it's the world, but it's kind of like this modern thing where it's all about school and, you know, education, but we can't forget that things, you know, even special effects, makeup effects, it's a trade, and, you know, I wish I can go back in time and back to, like, the apprentice program. And it's, you know, people didn't go to school. They would pick their profession, whether they were the blacksmith or, you know, whatever it is. And they would go and just work with people doing it. There are really good schools out there that will teach you things. But when you get exposed to the industry, you're still kind of at ground zero. It's not like, you know, doctors or lawyers or where there's this set path. You do X amount of years of school, you do X amount of years of residency. You know, my advice, you have to do what's comfortable for you, but if you really want to do what I do or, you know, what we do or be in the film industry, the best bet is to go out there and just meet people and start working with them and build up. And my crew will tell you, and like I said, feel free to talk to them. I mean, a lot of these guys came to me as interns or like first timers. And if you have the talent, if you have the ability, like the people will see that right away. And, you know, I mean, well, let's talk about some people right here. So Red 5, stand up, Red 5. Red 5 is my art director, and she handles, like, she's mainly responsible for making MINECON happen, because while I'm running around being creative, like, she's the one that's, like, really being like, this has to get done and making sure everything is here. But she came to me as an intern on, did anyone see Felicia Day's Dragon Age Redemption? Slow clap, yeah. But that was, you know, based on a video game. We were trying to bring it to life and film this thing. She came on as an intern, had never really done, like, physical prop making or anything before, but really wanted to do it, and just instantly proved herself within a couple weeks. So on the next job, I hired her. Now it's been 3 years and 3 MINECONs, and she is my main person. And Amish, where's Amish? Everybody has nicknames too, so, but maybe they'll tell you their real name. But I met Amish at a thing. He was screening his thesis project, right, at film school, and everyone else was doing things about like actors in Hollywood trying to make it, or like all the things that kids do in film school. But he made this thing with like giant robots and like all this cool stuff, and it was weird because all the other film students were kind of like, oh, well, you know, we knew that wouldn't turn out that great. And it's like, I thought that was the greatest thing I've ever seen. And so I met him after, and I was making my own movie for Sci-Fi Channel, and I had, you know, robots and spaceships. And I was like, hey, you want to come help me out on a movie? And he was like, what are you doing? I'm like, I'm making spaceships. And he's like, I'll be there tomorrow. And he's never left. And that's like, what? That's like 6 years, right? So, you know, the thing is, who else can we introduce and talk to you about over there? Oh, Carrie, yes. So Carrie is a fellow East Coaster, and you went to, I get so many people from your school, Emory, right? Emerson, yeah. But she was she actually reached out to the guild and wanted to come work in the art department, and they, actually, did you just... general production, but you were interested in art department?
They were looking for general production, but I was in the art.
Right, so she reached out to general production, said, hey, I'm interested in art department. They sent her over to me, and you know, she just rose to the top and then became permanent person right away. So it's like, you know, it's all about you, how much you want to put into it, how much you love it. But I will guarantee you this. I know I'm probably going to get like hate mail from schools, but if you find the right person, if you come out to the barnyard or like some shop and, you know, for a summer or something, and just, you know, open your mind and put everything into it, we will teach you more in that summer for free than you will learn in any of the courses for production design or makeup effects, or, you know, and if you're, you know, if you have the abilities, then you will end up being the next person that's permanently part of some crew.
Awesome. Okay, I'm going to take this one last question because I think we're really over time and Greg has some stuff to give out.
Yes. Right?
Okay, so here you go. Last question. Make it good.
Out of all the projects you have done, what's the one you worked as hard as you could and put as much detail in as you could?
For projects in general?
Mm-hmm.
I would have to say MINECON 2013. We, every project, you know, we put all of our effort into it, but I definitely wanted to, this year, just put lots of detail. I just wanted you guys to be able to walk around. I know there's so much to do, and I didn't want you to have to, you know, be caught up in anything, but I want you to just be able to look at every little thing and see all these little details that you might have missed before. Just because what I didn't want is for you to walk in and be like, barnyard, okay, that's cool. And, you know, like, I want you to go back and see it. There are all kinds of little Easter eggs hidden throughout, especially in the experience. So definitely, you know, if you see any of them or you think you see any of them, tweet me or Instagram a picture to me, and, you know, I'll give you something special for that. So keep an eye out. Hardcore Easter eggs.
Too. Yeah, and as far as the Minecraft experience goes, Vu and I visited Greg's house, and it's like each of those pieces was hand done. So if there's spots on an animal, like one of them painted those on the animal. If there's vines on a tree, they didn't just buy that at the store. He hand cut them for, who did the vines?
Kago
did the vines for a week. Hand cutting and gluing them on.
They're perfect.
Like incredible.
I'm not going to lie. We did look on Amazon first for Minecraft vines in quarter inch scale, but they didn't exist.
Please give Greg the biggest round of applause. He is the coolest person basically ever. And their entire team, because they have tirelessly worked to put on MineCon. So before you all run out, though, do you want to tell them what you have?
Yeah. So I also, on the side, to keep extra busy. I have a little company. It's called floppits.com. We make little collectible PVC characters on a Velcro tether. And you can wear them anywhere. You can put them on your lanyards at the show. You can link multiple ones together and make bracelets. I personally use them to wrangle all my cables. And, yeah, Lydia's wearing them. But Lydia and Mojang was nice enough to let me make some exclusive ones for the convention. We have some of these MINECON ones that are being handed out, like if you see me and get my autograph. But I have some special ones that are just for you guys that came to the panel. They're the Creeper. And, yeah, these are the only ones that are going to be available. So we're going to give them out. I don't know how we're going to give them out. Okay, yeah, we'll bring him over to the door, and you can get him out. And then if you see me, I'll sign him and stuff. But thank you so much, guys.